What I want to share with you is the most important agenda of Muslims in this country is to raise a good family. We have no other agenda than that one. To be the best husband we can be, to be the best wives we can be, to be the best mothers and fathers we can be, to raise the best sons and daughters we can raise. And to be the best sons and daughters we can be. This is our number one agenda. There's no other agenda. The institution of family is under attack. It's being destroyed. It's caving in from the inside. And we have to protect it. Now this institution of family, you know what gives it strength? What supports it? Is the masjid. The masjid protects the family. That's what it's supposed to do anyway. The masjid is a place where you're supposed to be involved, not as just a man, not as just a married couple, not just for the boys. It's supposed to be a place for the entire family. It's supposed to be where families learn their religion, where they learn to meet other Muslims and create a culture of Islam. What's the other place you're going to meet Muslims? Regularly. The weekly convention Muslims have is the Jum'ah prayer. Right? That's so it has our families need to be connected to the masajid. Now, the other thing is our masajid cannot survive until they have involvement from the entire family. When our masajid only have involvement from the men, fights break out. When our masajid only have involvement from some group from the community, fights break out. When the masajid have involvement from the entire family, the priorities stay straight. We do things for kids, we do things for women, we do things for men, we take care of every element of a community. So the community needs the family, and the family needs the community. They both need each other. If you try to raise a family disconnected from the masjid, disconnected from, when I say community, I actually mean masjid. Please understand, when I say community, I mean masjid. When you try to raise a family that's practically disconnected from the masjid, disconnected from the community, you are asking for trouble. Because over time, it will become easier and easier for you to let go of more and more of the religion. Families that moved out to some random boondocks where the dad got a job and there's no masjid out there and he's raising his kids by himself, only Muslim family, two Muslim families in the entire town, after 10, 15 years when their kids are teenagers, they're the ones that are writing emails that you can sense the tears when they were writing them. What should I do with my kids? I don't know, I don't know what happened between me and my wife. Because there was no community. So the family started falling apart. We need each other. You know, the communities in Texas have a huge advantage. We really do. We have a huge advantage. I come from New York. We don't have that kind of advantage, I'm telling you. Most communities, we don't have that advantage. We have an immense advantage here. We have the opportunity, we have all the ingredients, we gotta use them though. We gotta put them together now. It's not, we're just getting started. The masajid have been built by the mercy of Allah. Now it's time to bring them to life. Now it's time to fill them with our families. So inshallah we'll talk practical steps about that and some really important considerations that all of us need to have in developing healthy communities inshallah ta'ala. After our break, I'll give you guys a 10-minute break. Is that the official verdict? 10 minutes? Okay, 15. Go make some long distance phone calls. Go. All right, go. I'll talk to you in 15 minutes. Assalamu alaikum. I don't want to sit down and talk because I can't see you. And if you can't see me, you'll start talking to each other. And that's also problematic. Okay. So I want to dedicate this last session, or section, to... I'm sorry, it is the last section. No! Houston's very passionate people. Okay, so I want to dedicate this last conversation to something that I find very relevant and I think important, and it should be brought to the awareness of as many communities as possible. I've talked about it on multiple occasions before. I don't know if it's made its way up onto YouTube or not, but I'll share it with you anyway. And what I want to talk to you about is the fundamental differences between a cult and a community. The fundamental differences between a cult and a community. So there's two words here now, cult and community. In a cult, everybody's supposed to look the same. They're supposed to talk the same. They're supposed to walk the same. They're supposed to dress the same. They're supposed to say the same thing. They're supposed to acknowledge validity from the same source. It's this like, create zombies. Right? That's what a cult is. Nobody can think for themselves. Nobody can disagree from the opinion that everybody else has. If you disagree even a little bit, you're a hypocrite, you're a sellout, you're a kafir, you're a munafiq, you're a fasiq. Every name you can find in the book is you. In a community, differences are welcome. You can be different from others. Your language can be different, the way you dress is different, maybe even your understanding can differ. Your teachers may be different than other people's teachers. In religion, you can have different teachers. A community is diverse. A cult is cut off. This is one thing. A cult says, we are the only right way. And anybody who says even a little bit different from us is off the straight path. So if you want to save yourself, don't listen to them. Don't listen to anybody but us. We'll save you. A cult does this. A community says, this is what we've come to understand. We know there are other people who disagree with what we have to say. We welcome a conversation. We're willing to understand what others have to say. We're willing to exchange ideas in a healthy way within Muslims and even with non-Muslims. So this is not just this differentiation between Muslims, but even if non-Muslims have something they disagree with us in, instead of calling them kafir, and they're the ones, don't listen to them, we can invite them and we can have a healthy conversation with them in a respectful fashion. That's what a community does. In a cult, when somebody makes a mistake, when somebody gets out of line, they're cut off. You're no good. You know, you're a munafiq now, you're a hypocrite now. You didn't do what was expected of you. In a community, when somebody makes a mistake, the point of the community is to pick them back up and brush the dust off of their clothes and say, come on, everybody makes mistakes, it's okay. Well, we're here to help you. It's a big difference. That's what a community does. A cult passes judgment on people. It establishes that the leader is superior to the followers. And all the followers basically have really low self-esteem. They put all of their confidence in a leader. They themselves have no regard. They have no respect, really. And they have low self-esteem even for themselves. You'll find in a cult, that members of a cult, they'll never speak for themselves. They always say, our cult leader said. I'm not going to replace the word cult leader with what they use. But they'll use somebody who always said. They can never even speak on their behalf. They can't think for themselves. It's impossible. And they attribute this kind of almost absolute authority to their cult leader. In a community, there's actually an open conversation between leadership and the people. And people can even criticize leadership and say, I don't think what you're doing is right. Or I'd like you to explain why you're doing this. Because I think there's a better way of doing it. And that's not taken as offensive, so long as it's not presented in an offensive way. So the community understands how to disagree in a respectful way. And leadership understands how to take those disagreements and respond to them in a respectful way. And there's this open channel communication. One of the most important differences. When somebody joins a cult, they become distant from their family. When somebody joins a cult, the cult says your family is part of fitna. You should stay away from them. They take you away from deen. Your family is dunya, it's worldly. Don't worry about your family, worry about deen. The community says, no, your family is part of your deen. Making your family better, taking care of your family, spending time with your family is a part of your religion. You have to do it. You have to be a good dad and a good husband and a good father and all this stuff, a good mother. You know? So where a community makes family stronger, a cult can destroy families. A cult can take people away from their families. Fathers who no longer act like fathers. Husbands who no longer act like husbands. They don't fulfill their roles. A lot of masjids across America are cults. And very, very few masjids across America are communities. We have to make the effort of making all of the masajid across the country into communities. You know the last comment I made in my last session? You can't have the masjid operate properly without having what involved? Family. When you have family involved, it won't become a cult. It won't become a cult. It can't. When the family's uninvolved, there's just some people involved, and one or two personalities dominate, and it starts becoming a cult. And it just gets hijacked, and then some personalities take over the show. And that's what ends up happening. And everybody means well in the beginning. But this is just not how the world operates. We have to make an extra effort to create communities. To create community. It's a big priority. It's a huge priority for us in this country. So I wanted to start our conversation from that. And then I want to take you to this, just some practical components of Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi anil Munkar, the last thing we talked about, and then move on to the next ayat that are coming since we have time, alhamdulillah.